Well, thank you, John, for inviting me to give my testimony about how I came to leave the Lord. It's the opposite testimony of how somebody comes to the Lord. The way I have this presented, I'd like to just talk for 15 minutes and then have a Q&A for about 15 minutes. So, John, if you can let me know.
Okay.
You know, 5 and 3 minutes.
I will.
You know, it's kind of funny. A lot of people think, you know, how could you escape religion? Or, you know, if you're one time, I met one person who was a Catholic. I was a Catholic, and I said I was no longer a Catholic. This is when I was still a Christian. She goes, how did you escape Catholicism? So I went even further than that. I escaped Christianity altogether. So I'm going to talk about that now. Going into this, I wanted to talk about what my mindset was, because that's probably really important. I was a born-again Christian for over 25 years, since becoming a born-again Christian in about 1984, after college. And since then, I developed in the faith. I was really interested in apologetics and evangelism. Apologetics is defending the faith. Evangelism is, you know, presenting the gospel to people. In the course of that, I would debate with different people, starting with Catholicism, because I came from a Catholic family, so it's like, why aren't you a Catholic? So, you know, and plus I want to reach them, so I learned about Catholicism and even more to debate them. And then there, along the lines, there was also Mormons and Muslims and different faith groups. And then finally, the last group was an atheist group, and so I wanted to debate atheists, and so I would ask them, you know, what's their strong point, because I want to beat them at their strong point. And it became apparent to me that their strong point was, they said, science. And so I said, fine, you know, I'm a Christian, I can believe in science, so I'll learn more science to beat you at your own game, kind of thing. So going into this, so that's a different thing with debating with atheists and all other religious groups, because all other religious groups, for example, if you had a Christian versus a Muslim versus a Jewish person, they all start with the common understanding that there's a God, so you don't even talk about questions, does God exist? So talking to atheists is a totally different realm, because now you have to go down to the basement level and talk about, does God even exist? So it's a whole different arena than debating with other religious groups. So going into this, my mindset was, you know, I really turned into a seeker too, because I wanted to know the truth, and I started studying evolution, and it was quite a challenge, and I knew there's a challenge, and so I basically committed to myself that I would place the truth above everything. And for a Christian, that might seem strange. How could you put truth seeking above even God? And I figured I was safe in doing that, because Jesus said in the Gospels that I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so if that's true, the more I seek the truth, the more I should find Jesus. So it shouldn't be a threat. Another thing I considered is that, you know, being a parent myself and having children, when a child comes home from school and gets a good grade, I'm proud of them. And so, you know, if I have a father in heaven, he should be proud of me to use my brain to the fullest extent. So those are some things that drove me, that I didn't think it would be idolatry to put truth above God, because, you know, it should find out God, basically, if God created everything. So I guess I made the rounds as far as the origins go, positions for Christianity. As a Catholic growing up, you know, up to high school, I didn't think there was a problem. I never heard there was a problem with evolution, never took Adam and Eve seriously, or the, you know, story of the Noah's Ark seriously. Then when I became a born-again Christian, I found out, wow, there's really people that take these stories seriously. So it was a challenge for me. You know, this earth is really, you know, according to young earth creationists, a very strict Baptist kind of Bible church I went to, it's, you know, the earth is 6,000 years old, the universe is 6,000 years old, people were made by creation, a miracle of God, not by evolution. So it was a very much of a challenge for me, but that was the way I wanted to go, so that's the way I looked into things. As I dug into these deeper, strangely enough, I had fellow Christians who would say, well, you know, Bernie, that's not really, you know, there's problems with this young earth creationism. And I started learning more about science. I said, okay, that's right. So I became an old earth creationist, basically gradually accepting more science. So basically the old earth creationists, they accept modern science for cosmological things, like the age of the earth and the age of the universe, but they still reject evolution. So in studying the evolutionary arguments in order to debate atheists, I came to accept evolution especially from arguments in the DNA, such as pseudogenes, which show evidence of copying. And one reason why that's such a strong evidence to me is because in the computer industry, there was a very interesting case because I work on computer chips. We have microcode in our chips, and one time we accused somebody else of copying our design, and they said no, we didn't. And so it was, well, we said, well, you know what? There's multiple ways to code this, and you use the same code we did. And not only that, we have mistakes, and you have the same mistakes. So it's like, okay. So they went back into the clean room and did everything from scratch, and that's how you get away from this stuff. And so when you look at the DNA arguments, it's like, wow, it's the same exact thing. There's copying. You can see from the genomes when they don't have to be that way. There's different ways to write the code, and it turns out it's written the same way. Not only that, there's errors in there, there's junk in there, and that's also copied. So there's no way out of that. Anyway, it's a long topic. So I came to accept evolution, and you know, I was almost ready to leave the faith at that point, but I was involved with these groups of Christians called the ASA, the American Scientific Affiliation. A lot of these Christians have, a lot of them are professors at Christian colleges. A lot of them have PhDs. People like Francis Collins is in this group. So basically, they don't have an official position. You can be a young earther if you want in there, an old earther, or evolutionary creationist. They want to be open to all the positions, but yet they're not hostile to evolutionary creationists like the old earthers and young earthers would be. So if it wasn't for that group, I would have left Christianity about a year earlier. So people like Francis Collins made me stay in Christianity about an extra year. That was a big hit to my faith, this evolution. The second hit was the idea of a soul. I went to one of these ASA conferences, and they brought up things I never thought about, and that was, they were saying, well, maybe the soul emerges. It's not just given by God as a miracle kind of thing. It just emerges with the body as it grows. And I thought, you know, there's serious evangelicals putting this idea out there, and it's like, well, if that's true, then what's the difference between a soul and just a mind? And so I revisited what the soul is in my theology textbooks and found that it was very weak in some of them. They didn't even discuss it. And my favorite theology book had a very lengthy description about the different camps of what they think about this, even within Christianity. And then the author says, here's my viewpoint and why. So I thought, you know, you can't even define what the soul is, and people don't even know what this is. And it seems like everything the mind is, the soul could be explained. So, you know, what does the soul give you? Humans are supposed to be made in the image of God. What is that, you know? Well, obviously it's not, they would say, obviously it's not God looks like a human. So then what is this image of God? Well, maybe it's our capacity to love. But then we find out from studies with animals, well, animals show love. Okay, well, it's our ability to think, you know? Well, animals show that. Okay, well, what's our moral ability? Well, animals have morals, but they show morals also. I think the last thing that they might say is, well, it's our relationship to God. Well, that's, you know, if God is an imaginary character and you have a relationship, what's the big deal about that? You know, you could have a relationship to Santa Claus or whatever. How's that anything special? So I thought, is there anything that could disprove the soul? And I thought, well, there's probably no way. You know, bottom line, maybe I should still be a Christian, because if Jesus rose from the dead, that changes everything. Who knows? I mean, who cares about all these scientific difficulties? Maybe it's all still about, you know, Jesus came to life, you know, back to life, and he gave that promise to us. I wonder if there's any way to disprove that. And at first I thought, of course not, but then I got some ideas. I thought, wait a minute, you know, in the Bible, it talks about in the Gospels how when Jesus died on the cross, it talks in one version of the Gospels, not in the other ones, about how these dead people came back to life, and they were the saints of old, and they walked into the towns, and what's going on here? Who are these people? Did they go back in the graves at night? Did they have families? Did they die again? There's no word about this. It seems like it's kind of a fantastic story that was just thrown in there. And another thing is, and that always bothered me as a Christian too. You know, there's certain passages that Christians will bring up over and over again. This is so edifying and everything, but they don't bring up this passage about the dead people coming from the graves. It's one of those passages you hope people don't read about, and we don't want to really have to try to explain it. But I think another damaging story in the Bible is in Acts. It talks about Jesus ascending into heaven. And if you made that story up with their mindset when they wrote that, they thought heaven really was up there. So if you're going to make up a story about Jesus going to heaven, you're going to say, yeah, I saw him go up to the clouds, and he even went beyond the clouds. We couldn't see him. You know, that's where heaven is, up there somewhere. But nowadays, since we have spaceships up there and everything, we know there's not a heaven up there. So nowadays, everybody knows, yeah, heaven's in a different dimension. So if they're going to write that story today, they would say, Jesus, he dissolved into another dimension. But if you had the mentality of them, you would say he went up he went, you know, we couldn't see him anymore. He must have went up to heaven like a spaceship, you know. And even in Acts story, it says, you know, just there are some angels that appeared and said, yeah, just as you see Jesus leaving into heaven, that's how he's going to come back again from heaven. So here, you know, the Christians think Jesus is going to come in the clouds, you know, from heaven. So, you know, is that just special effects, or is heaven really up there, or do they get caught telling a lie? You know, why would Jesus go up there if there's not heaven up there? It's just for special effects. I mean, that doesn't make sense. You know, he just wants to impress people by doing that kind of a magic trick. Like Chris Angel, you know, he does levitation like that. So, as far as evolution, the reason why that's such a heavy problem is because, according to the Christian gospel, we're sinners. And Jesus is the answer for that sin. Well, why are we sinners? Well, because God made a perfect creation at one point, and humans fell from that. Well, from evolution, we know that evolution happens over periods of time with populations of people. There's no such thing as the first Adam and Eve or a first human. It's not like a monkey or an ape gives birth to a human. It doesn't work that way. It happens gradually over a population. So it doesn't make sense that there was this fall. There was this perfect state, and then people fell. And again with the soul, it brings up all these questions. You know, somebody might say, well, you can believe in evolution as long as God gives humans a soul at some point. Well, how do you give a soul to this group of? I mean, you're going to start with one person, or are you just going to choose, here's a guy and a girl, Adam and Eve, we'll give them a soul, but not these people, and their kids are going to have souls, and then they're going to intermix and interbreed. With evolution, there's just tons of problems with this whole Adam and Eve thing. And from my experience, I mean, this is a mystery. If you ask an evolutionary creationist, how did sin come into the world? It's a mystery, because they're not going to say there's a literal Adam and Eve. Some might, but I mean, this is a big problem. So I wanted to leave my presentation there and take questions. And I want you to ask me ask me if you think I'm way off base. Go ahead, ask me any question you want to. You're not going to offend me. So
I just want to know, what do you think was the biggest impact between when you believed and when you came to that realization? Like where you are now, how do you think the difference in your life is? Is there a difference in the believing life that you live and the life now without religion?
Is there a difference in how I live my life?
Or your feeling on things?
Yeah. I guess one of the big things to overcome is religion. If you look on the internet, there's this thing called terror management theory, that people are afraid to die, and religion might be a really good answer for that. It's like, hey, don't worry about it. You're going to live forever, you know, if you do what we tell you to do, you know? Mm-hmm. So, as a Christian, I was very secure that, you know, I was a friend of God, and I was going to go to heaven, and not believing in God anymore. Now I don't, you know, believe in that anymore. So now it's really kind of depressing in some ways to deal with mortality. That's a whole subject in itself, because there's a whole lot of positive things to say about it. Like I was talking to my son on the way over here. You know, imagine if you could live for forever. You know, after a zillion years, let's say you're saying, I'm tired of this, after a zillion up to a zillion power, I'm tired of this, I want to end it. Are they going to say, sorry, you can't end it? And what if they say, okay, you can end it now. So what does it matter if you lived 10 years or a zillion years? There's still another zillion years, infinity, that you're not going to be there. So, you know, in the grand scope of everything, you know, it seems like living for eternity doesn't really make any sense anyway. So anyway, it's a challenge to find out what's the meaning of life, and that's one thing I've been doing, and it's a whole different thing. But, you know, more of living for yourself now, you can think about what's your personality, what are your interests, and develop yourself more fully and appreciate life more deeply. Because as a Christian, you can say, hey, let's go to battle, you know, I'm going to fight for God and country, you know. But when you're an atheist, you're not going to say, I'm going to fight for God and country. This is a precious life. I'm not going to war unless it's really necessary, you know. So as a Christian, it's easier to throw away your life, I think. Yeah.
Two-part question. Part one is, do you classify yourself as more of a skeptic, more of an atheist, more of a humanist on this side of the fence compared to the other side? And then the second question is, how has your new belief in the three categories that gave you, how does that impact your family and friends and their relationship with you?
Yeah, you know, everybody's unique, so I probably have a really unique situation.